name is Lori. I also go by Laura. My real name is Laura. So if some of you have my business card, you might see Laura on it. But I also go by Lori because there was a Laura before me and there's another Laura at our agency. So my clients were very confused by that. So now I started going by Lori, trying to not create confusion. But on my business card, it says Laura. And that's sometimes an issue as well. Okay, so the first thing I want to start with is I'm going to throw out some names, and I want a show of hands of how many of you heard of this? How many of you heard of EBT? Okay. EBT. Yes. How many have seen that logo when you go to the grocery store on certain items?
Oh, yeah.
Okay. How many of you heard of WIC? Okay. So that's great. And have any of you heard of MassHealth? What about, it's called, I think they're calling it now Obama phones. Obama phones. They're cell phones for low-income households. So, yes, but the other name for it is Safely Wireless and Assurance Wireless. But majority of the time, if you run into someone, if you go to your Department of Transitional Assistance, also which I will call DTA, there will be some individuals outside with a little bag in hand signing people up to receive, and they will call it Obama phones. Yes. Okay, so we're going to get started. If you have any questions, please raise your hand. This is the same exact orientation that the refugees are going to go through. Unfortunately, someone put this together, and I haven't had a chance to go over with a fine-tooth comb, so I'm going to go through it, and if anything is wrong, I will point it out and correct it, okay? Whenever you're ready, you can hit the next slide. So we're gonna start off with welcoming in the new family, and we're gonna do it in their own language. Go to the next slide. Okay, so this whole orientation talks about the services, support, care, help, and how we're going to guide this family. Okay, so, this is what the agency is, so we're supposed to provide basic needs support first 30 days after arrival, and I'm gonna go what we're supposed to actually provide. We're going to actually go beyond that first 30 days because we don't think a family can be self-sufficient within 30 days. So the first step is housing. So our agency, we're in charge of finding housing, making sure it's affordable housing, making sure it's suitable housing. We don't want to put families in overcrowded situations, so we want to make sure it's adequate space for that family. Okay, we're going to provide the family with a home orientation. So it's called Home Safe Home. So meaning when the family arrives, we're going to go in on that same night. And even though it's going to be late, we have to go over some safety things with the family because we want them to know how to use an extinguisher, how to work the stove, because we don't want to leave them in that home and then something terrible happens and they don't know how to reach out to us. So it's a home orientation, and it goes over the basics of the housing, like how to use a refrigerator, how to turn on the heat, who to call when you need help. And for the first night, it's just going to be basic for them, but then over time it's going to get more detailed. Furnishing. So we're supposed to provide the family with all the furniture that they will need, and unfortunately this is supposed to come out of the money that they receive coming here. So each family, does anyone know how much the family is going to receive?
$1,200 the first 3 months.
Nope. So they receive, each individual will receive $1,125, and that is it. So once that is done, they don't have any more money. So we're supposed to use that to pay for their housing. We're supposed to use that to buy furniture. We're supposed to use that to buy clothing, food, and any other basic needs that the family would need. Yeah, no, this is only for the 30 days. So, and then we're gonna sign them up with other services. So food, like I said, we're supposed to provide them with food. On the first night the family arrives, they have to have a meal prepared for them by someone of their same culture and background. So it can't be, if we wanna make sandwiches, we can't make sandwiches. It has to be, if they eat goat where they come from, then maybe a goat stew. So we have individuals and we have a list of food that we're going to put into the apartment so that the family will have food for the first 3 days until they're actually able to go shopping on their own. Clothing, so like I said, we have to provide clothing, and unfortunately, we don't know these individual sizes. So we have their height and we have their weight, hopefully it's accurate, and we're guessing because unfortunately, most of these families are coming from a hot climate here. So there may be a family or family that arrives tomorrow. They may not have coats, they may not have shoes. So unfortunately, we can't guess their shoe size, so we're gonna have to make do with what we have. And hopefully we're gonna get them situated. But for clothing, coats, we're gonna pack it all in the car and hopefully at the airport, put on coats, try on some temporary clothing just so they'll have something because it's cold here. And we don't want no one freezing. And I heard horror stories about individuals getting off the plane and it's freezing rain and there's no umbrella, there's no coat. So they're soaking wet. And then when they arrive at their new home, there's no clothing for them to change into. So we're not going to do that. We're going to make sure even if it's not the proper size clothing, there's still going to be something. Okay, so other services. So within the first 30 days, whichever circles of care and once you get your own families to work with, you will notice that we have a strict timeline. The timeline is something that is not put in place by us. It's the timeline that is put in by our volunteer agency. So they tell us when and where we're supposed to do certain things. So for example, it says home visit must be completed within 24 hours of arrival. So that means if we have the family arrive on Friday, then that means I have to go out there Saturday to do a home visit with that family. It says within 5 days, we have to take them to apply for social services benefits. So there's no leeway. Within those 5 days, we have to get the family to whatever the local office is to apply. Ooh, get close. I have a cord back there in this little snowman. Thank you. So there's going to be strict guidelines where we have to go. Sometimes we're gonna give the families days that they can rest and stuff like that, but it's very important that we achieve our timeline and we stay on task so that the family won't miss out on crucial benefits. If you hit close, okay. So
are the leaders of our circle, mm-hmm, going to divvy out for us what we're gonna do and who's gonna go to Social Security, you know, who's gonna do what? How is that gonna work?
I was under the impression that your leaders will do that. Okay. We would have, we're gonna have a calendar set up showing what is going to take place on which days so that everyone that's working with the families will know. So like if it's the family's off day, you know the family has an off day, maybe you wanna go in and take them to the park or show them around where the local stores are and stuff like that. So you will know which their off days are, you'll know which afternoons they're gonna have free and stuff like that.
And so it's my understanding that some of us are gonna go to the airport and get them. And so does that happen with you?
That goes through your leader.
Okay.
Yes, yes.
So in terms of language, you're gonna take a family, let's say there's a mom and a dad and two kids, and you're gonna say, we have to go to the Social Security office to,
yes,
get social, but they don't speak English and I don't speak Burundi or Arabic,
so
or whatever.
We're gonna have interpreters.
And so
place.
There will be an interpreter in,
yes,
each of these situations.
So and especially in these majors, so like going to their health assessment, we're required to have an interpreter. Going to the Social Security office, we have to have an interpreter. Registering the children for school, setting up transportation for job interviews and stuff like that, and job training, and applying for public benefits. There's a lot of crucial steps where we actually will need the interpreters. Some agencies will provide their own interpreters, like for the first initial health appointment, the agency may provide their own interpreters to speak with the family. And for example, both of the families arriving, they actually have family that's already here. So it's gonna be good that they won't be isolated. They will have family to come. So that will help you communicate with them as well. Okay, we can go to the next one. Okay, so we're supposed to provide transportation for job interviews, job training, and healthcare appointments. We're going to provide transportation for way more than that, because the client isn't going to know where to go for the grocery store, where to go if they want to go to the park. So we're gonna provide transportation and connect them with the volunteers so that they can get to know the community. Yes?
Who makes the healthcare appointments? Does the Charities do that, or Circle help with that, or are there certain clinics we're supposed to go to? Or
yes. So Catholic Charities Agency, for the first two initial appointments, so there's two initial appointments that they have to go to, and this has to be at Karen Health Center in Springfield. So they hold the contract, because as you know, our family's coming over, they don't have insurance. So the Karen Health Center actually has a contract in place where they're going to provide, they call it the initial health assessment, and then they will, we will work with them to determine if the family needs follow-up care, and if the family that is being placed in Northampton, we're going to work with Northampton to have their medical provider here, because we don't want the family having to travel to Springfield every time. So the closer to home, the better, but unfortunately the first two appointments have to be there, and there may be some follow-up appointments between those two that they have to go to the Karen Health Center for before Karen Health Center releases them.
And they have pediatrics there?
Yes, they do. They have adult medicine, pediatrics, and dental. Okay. Yep, so this is the health assessment services. So we're going to provide healthcare referrals and provide transportation. It says to two refugee health appointments. So we're only required to provide transportation to two, but we're going to provide a lot more transportation than that. Because sometimes you'll see a lot of families who won't follow up or miss appointments. So we're gonna stay on top of it. And I have a good connection with Karen Health Center to start with, and then moving forward, whoever their primary care physician will be, we're gonna build that relationship. So that way the caseworker knows if the client has an appointment in advance. So that way the client doesn't say, oh, I forgot, or we get a call saying the client missed like four very important appointments and they don't know what's going on. Assistance applying for Social Security cards and Social Security numbers. So the client has to actually go to the Social Security office and do actual in-person interview. So the caseworker and an interpreter will take them to that office. And if a Circle of Care member is assisting with that, then they'll go with the family as well.
And that's in Springfield?
That we identified a location in Holyoke, so there's Social Security office in Holyoke. Right now, that's the one that we will go to, and hopefully there's no issues with that, because if there's an issue, then we have to go to the Springfield location.
Holyoke's really small.
Yeah.
So are they automatically on a path to citizenship when they arrive, or how does that work?
So they are, but there's a certain time frame they have to wait. I'm not sure of all the actual requirements, but I believe they have to wait 1 year, and then they can receive a green card. And then once they hit a certain mark, they can apply for citizenship, but it's 5 years. And then they still have to take the citizenship test, so we'll help them prepare for that and stuff like that. And for some of our families, that's going to be very crucial, especially the families who aren't able. So if they have a disabled adult that's receiving SSI. Has anyone heard of SSI?
Yeah.
So that family, for that benefits for a refugee, they can only receive that up to 7 years. And if they're not a citizen, then they will stop the benefits. Yes.
Can they apply for work without being a Social Security card?
So, yes, they're going to receive an appointment card. So, yes, they can, they're all ready to work once they come. So once they come, we're going to apply for, it's called the I-94, and it actually gives their face when they entered the U.S. and stuff like that. And then that triggers for them to actually get their employment card.
So they'll come in with the I-94 photo ID?
It's an I-94. It's actually, they used to come with the paper. It was actually a nice card. But unfortunately now we have to go. So once they arrive within 24 hours, we have to go on the internet and we have to pull that up. And it's a piece of paper. We're going to laminate it. Hopefully, depending on how big it is, we're going to laminate it. So that way it's more sturdy for the family. Because even the refugee families that we see coming in now that... have been here a while and stuff like that, you see their paper is messed up. But the people who came in here before and has the card that's already laminated, that's still nice and neat. So whatever we can laminate, we're gonna laminate it so and keep it organized. So we're also, we have to register the children for school. At this point, oh yes, we do have children coming, but they're going to be resettled in Westfield. It's an adult mom and two children. They're going to be resettled in Westfield because they have family in Westfield that's going to actually assist in taking care of them. Yes?
Do they start receiving any access to vaccines before they come? Or is there any holdout with DPH for the school required vaccinations?
So, no. So, they will receive that once they get here. So, they receive some vaccinations. But in order to go to school here, they have to receive a complete list of vaccines. So they have to receive that before they can be registered for school. Some of the appointments may be delayed, but I'm working with Care and Health Center. So if the child can't get in to see, because we have to register them for school within 30 days, I would like to see a child to go to school within the first week if possible, because I don't want to delay their education. So I know some agencies said that they take the children in and the children meets with the nurse and the nurse will give them all their shots. So that way we can register them for school more quickly than having to wait.
Just a comment as a medical provider, kids can have really, it's really not good to give kids a zillion shots all at once.
That's not scientific.
And unfortunately,
off topic.
And unfortunately, I don't know how they do the shots there. So I don't know if it's two visit, one visit, or three visits. But I don't know. So we'll have to speak to them to see actually how they actually do the shots. Okay, we can skip. So at this point, the refugees' families would have received a break. So this one is public benefits enrollment. So DTA, Department of Transitional Assistance, SNAP, food stamps. So that's what the card would look like. So it's a card with their face on it. In the back, it has like a little magnetic barcode where you'll swipe it just like a credit card. Has anyone ever seen one used at a grocery store or know how you will use it at the grocery store? Yep, you'll swipe it just like, you'll swipe it so they have the machine. So just like where you go to swipe your credit card, your debit card, the family will swipe that card. And then the family will hit food or cash, because some families will have cash. Some families will just have food. So you select what you're going to pay for. So if it's food items, you'll select food. And then they're going to ask the family for a PIN number. We're going to reinforce the family that remembering that PIN number is very important. So we're going to try to assist them with making an easy PIN number to start with.
So my apologies for not knowing enough about this, but what SNAP does is give you a lower price on, or is this more like an account with a certain amount of money on
yes.
it that comes out of that $1,100?
No. So when a family goes to the DTA office to apply for benefits, based on the family size and the family
this
income.
Is the allotment. Right.
Yes.
Okay.
They will receive a certain amount. So there are some families that, depend on their income, their household size, they can receive
$100. A month.
Yes, a month. And this is a month. This is the only amount they receive. The average family of four that I've worked with, that has no individuals in the household working, they receive roughly, I think it was around $400, and that was supposed to be for the month. there's some family, if the household's bigger, then you receive more. But say if a family comes here, they start off with receiving $500 a month in food stamps, just not cash, food stamps, on their card. And then they start working. That amount is going to go down. And hopefully that amount isn't going to stop altogether, because there is, they can stop the benefits altogether. We have a family of five that I was working with recently, and they were receiving benefits, and they came to me because they didn't understand why their benefits were lowered. They were receiving $850 a month. Both adults started working, and their oldest child started working, and they reported their income, and they reported the child's income. So that lowered their benefits to $16 a month. And the family, based on their income and what they were making, they were just making enough to get caught up on their back rent, because previously they weren't working, they didn't have all this income. So then it's like they need to make a choice. Do we not eat this month to pay our rent, or do we eat this month and not pay our rent and become homeless?
We have access, those people that are food insecure, we have access to food every single day in Northampton.
And that's great.
Nobody should go hungry in Northampton.
Because so the area I'm more familiar with is Springfield area. And the way it works there is that you can only go to the food pantries a certain amount of time. And so, and they only give you a certain amount of food based on your family size. So if you run out of that food and then you need more food, you can't go back until the following month. So, yes.
True.
Is it still the case that SNAP benefits exclude even crucial household items like toilet paper, diapers, tampons, pads?
We're going to get to that, yes. Yes.
And Department of Transitional Assistance, is that what we used to call welfare? Is that the welfare office?
Yes, the welfare office. So you'll hear people call it the welfare office. You'll hear people call it the EBT office, DTA office. So there's a lot of people who have different names, and I'm sure the refugees or families will make their own name and pick up their own name on what they want to call it. There's also the families. Some family will be eligible for cash benefits through this office. So if they're eligible, usually the child has to be under the age of 2 in order to be eligible for SNAP, for the cash benefits. So they would have to go, when we apply for the SNAP benefits, we have to apply for the cash benefits as well. And we also, at that office, they have to apply for MassHealth as well. So that's all done at one office. Oh, no, go back to the last one, please.
Oh, sorry.
So look, back to over here. So for the EBT, for the food stamp benefits, you're only allowed to buy food, and it's anything that is edible. But there are certain things. So how many of you go to Big Y and you see a hot chicken there? They have the hot food and then they have some cold food. Do any of you think that with ABT benefits you can buy the hot chicken? No food. Perfect. So can you buy the cold chicken? Yes, you can.
The same chicken and the one they put in the refrigerator?
Yep. So you have to wait till it cools down if you want the prepared chicken, and then go home and heat it up, unfortunately. But how many people, so you can't get anything hot. So, but if they have the cold prepared foods, you can buy that. And you will notice it's labeled. Some of the items, the grocery store started labeling, you'll see a blue label that says EBT. So you will see that labeled across the different food items. Can you pass that sheet out?
Yep.
I'm gonna pass a sheet out, and we're gonna go through it. And so these are different items that we're gonna go through.
What does EBT stand for?
Oh my goodness, electronic benefits
transfer.
Something like that. And SNAP, Supplemental Nutrition Assistance Program. It's just the name of the actual card. Does everyone have a paper? So we're gonna look at the first picture. It's a plate with burgers and fries. So can you go to McDonald's or Burger King with your EBT benefits?
No.
Okay. The next one is a platter of, it looks like ready-made sandwiches that you can get at Big Y. You know how they have the platter of the sandwiches sometimes. Do you believe you can get that with your EBT benefits? Yes, because it's cold. What about Pampers? No, you can't. What about Gerber Good Start, Gentlies, baby formula, any
yes,
type of?
Yes.
Yes, you can.
Also a WIC benefit,
yes.
Right?
Yes.
You
got a second. Yep. Alcohol beverages?
No.
No. Fruits and veggies?
Yes.
Flip it over.
And double at the farmer's market.
Yes, double at the farmer's market. Perfect. Can you buy lobster?
Sure.
Yes, you can. Yes. Fish? Can you buy the cooked fish that they have prepared? If it's cold, yes. What about that? The sushi. Can you buy that? Yes, you can. There's some agencies that are trying to ban families from buying these certain items. They want to tell families what they can and cannot buy. So they don't believe anyone receiving SNAP benefits should be allowed to buy steak, should be allowed to buy, if they want fish, certain types of fish. Not all fish, but certain types of fish. They shouldn't be allowed to buy lobster or crab or shrimp. Okay, and someone already mentioned the farmer's market. Yes, you can go to the farmer's market, and most of the time they will double your benefits.
And there's farm shares too.
Okay, perfect.
Is the top supposed to be dishware?
Yes, can you buy that? No, you can't.
No dishware?
No dishware.
Can't eat it.
We're going to put our families on the right path because there are a lot of, I don't know if you... There's a lot of stores that will work around the family, and basically they will overcharge them. So unfortunately, there's families who, there's certain stores, and if you ever see this, report them, because what they're doing is illegal. So there's certain stores, so if a family goes, and unfortunately the family will need a pack of wipes or a pack of baby Pampers and stuff like that. So the store will say, okay, I'll let you get that with your food stamp benefits, but I'm gonna charge you three times the amount.
Oh,
because certain size stores, when they scan, it just says, they can just type it in and say food items. So there's certain stores and they're starting to crack down. I know there was like three stores in the Springfield area that was caught doing that. Or there was people, which we're gonna make sure our families know the legal and illegal things. There was. So a client went into the store, they purchased $75 worth of soda. And then they sold it back to the store for $30 so they can get cash. There are certain stores that will buy the client's EBT benefits. So just be aware of that. So if you see something suspicious, something that you just don't think is right, like unfortunately some families may smoke, so if you see someone going in there, going to buying alcohol, and you know they only have food benefits, then that's something wrong. So you should bring that to the attention of your leaders so that they can bring it to our attention and that we can correct that issue with the family. Now, I'm not saying that's what all families are going to do, but in desperate situations, say if you need a pack of Pampers for your baby and you know the store at the corner is going to charge you $25 for that pack, I know majority of the people will probably go and just pay the $25 for a $5 pack of. And unfortunately, some of the agencies, like the food pantry, sometimes they don't have the right size that the family will need, or they don't have the right amount that they will need.
Okay.
Yes.
So I understand the Catholic Charities is doing some fundraising, and they may have, for instance, Target cards or something. So
yes,
if we run into a problem, we can go to the case manager and see
yes,
if we can get help.
Yes, exactly. So, and we're going to let our families know that don't be afraid to ask for something. If we're going to help them set up a budget, put a plan in place, but sometimes you run out, you're short. Sometimes you think you have the perfect plan, But something comes up, maybe your child is going on a school field trip and you don't want that child to be left out, so you paid the $15 for the school field trip. And then you realize it was another $5 for lunch. So you don't want them to be left out, so you give that money to them, and then you notice you're like $20 late. You don't have enough money for certain items in your household. So we don't want the family, we want them to know it's okay to ask for help. There are certain cultures where they have pride and they don't want to ask for help. We're going to let them know that it's okay to ask for help. There's no shame in doing so. So WIC. So women, infants, and children. So WIC is another card that the family will receive if the family has children under the age of 5. This is actually, this card is actually tells you what type of benefits you can receive. So when we take the family to the WIC office, they will go, they can, they let the family select what package they want. So some packages have more milk, some package may have some more cheese, or if the female is breastfeeding, she may get an additional package where she can get canned fish or other types of fish or other more dry beans as well.
Do they actually hand
the food? No, it's actually a card. It's a gold card, and they will give the family a list of when they're eligible to get the certain food items. And then they will, so they will give you a printout of when you're able to get the items, and then it will tell you when you're supposed to come back to renew your benefits with them. And the only way you're going to get more benefits if you keep your appointment, because they don't automatically load the benefits up. So with that being said, if you ever go to the grocery store, anyone, if you see there's certain items that says WIC, so for this particular benefits, there's certain cereal you can purchase. So basically, it's anything without sugar. And there's a certain amount, so say you can receive, usually the amount is 36 ounces of cereal. So some families will buy the small boxes, so they have more than one. Some people will buy the big, huge box. It all depends on what the family wants to do. You don't have to buy it all at once. So sometimes you can, if you have a young child, you can get like 4 gallons of milk. Usually no one needs 4 gallons of milk at once. So with that card, you could usually, before it used to be a check that they gave you, and the check, you have to receive everything on that check at once. So I think the card is more efficient for these families, because the card, it lets you pick and choose what you want to get that day. So if you need to go to the corner store, most of the corner stores accept WIC, and you'll go to that store and you can get a gallon of milk without having to go to the grocery store. And
it doesn't matter what that gallon costs. It's not an amount of money.
It's not an amount of money. Yes. Yes. They will tell you what percent you can receive, though. So there's ones that says you can receive whole milk. Or I believe it's either 1% or 2% milk that you can receive.
And there's like a health check involved with WIC too. When you
yes, there
and
is.
Get weighed and measured.
Yep, they you get weighed. They do. I forgot. They test
iron
you your iron. They do a little prick to test for iron. They look at the children. They ask you if you're eating okay, because they want to make sure you're eating properly and stuff like that. So they'll look at the adult and the child that's receiving benefits.
WIC can also connect you, they're in those appointments, with REACH, if there's any developmental screenings that young children need. The WIC people are great at that as well. And do they still have farmers market benefits as well?
I'm not sure if they still have, I believe they do, but I'm not sure. That's something we'll have to double check.
Yes.
So how often do they go to a WIC appointment then?
So the last time, it's been a while since I had a client who had it, but usually, the last time I knew that the client received like 3 months worth of benefits, and then after the 3 months, they had to go back.
And that, to go back, where was the
WIC office? So we're going to look at the local WIC office in Holyoke. I was told that there was one in the Northampton area, so we're going to connect with them as well to find the closest one for the family to go to.
It used to be at a soap mill. I don't know if it's still.
Yeah, so it used to be there. Okay, so we're going to make sure we find the closest one that they can go to. Yes?
On the staff benefits, is for the family, is it all put on one card or is it put on an individual card?
It's all put on one card, and the head of household has control over that card.
And how much is it?
It all depends on the family size.
Well, how much is it, so much per person?
To be honest, it's supposed to be. It goes by the family size. It goes by your income. They have a whole list of different criteria. Unfortunately, they wouldn't share the list with me fully. So I don't know what they actually count.
The secret list, huh?
Yes. Okay, so like we already spoke about WIC, they provide foods and supplements, including education, breastfeeding. They also provide education around breastfeeding. They will have women's group where you go and meet with other women to speak about how you're doing and stuff like that. So I think that's very educational. Yes.
It's, if I'm correct, it's 56 Vernon Street, Northampton.
Okay, perfect. Thank you very much.
Unless it's
WIC.
WIC. And where they have the postpartum.
So that's in the Head Start.
Yeah.
Okay, perfect. So that's the one that they will be going to.
Where is it?
56 Vernon Street, Northampton.
Initially, they will sign up in the Springfield office, but then transfer because in the Karen Health Center in Springfield, I think they changed it recently, though, but before they had everything in the same building. So you can go to your medical appointment, you can go to your dentist, and then you go around the corner to the pharmacy, and then you go to the WIC office. But I know they have a new clinic opening up, and they may have moved the WIC office. So we'll see. But if it's not available at the time they go for a medical appointment, then we'll automatically take them to the WIC office here. You can go to the next one. So the families will be eligible for MassHealth until they actually start working and become employable. So they'll receive health insurance and dental insurance. If the family is receiving cash benefits from their Department of Transitional Assistance, then Department of Transitional Assistance will fill out the application and everything. We won't have control over it, unfortunately. If it's a family without children that isn't going to be receiving cash benefits from Department of Transitional Assistance, then we have the option of basically filling out the application ourselves with the family or the Karen Health Center. They also, in Springfield, also has different agents that would be there to help fill out the proper paperwork. But our agency, we filled out for SNAP benefits, we filled out for MassHealth benefits before. And they'll receive a blue card to start with, and then once they receive that card, that's when we will actually be able to select the primary care physician for that family, and for the incoming family that's going to be resettled in Northampton, their primary care physician will be in Northampton.
Are there very many MassHealth primary care in
Northampton? We connect it with Bay State here.
Okay.
So there's other programs. So even if there's some families who are working, but they can't afford their employer's health insurance, so MassHealth can supplement that, where the family will pay a portion and then MassHealth will reimburse the family, or that they may have to pay a certain fee every month in order to receive the MassHealth. And usually it's low. There was a family of four that I was working with, and they had to pay. The children were free, so they didn't have to pay. But the two adults, it was $50 a month total. Okay. So unfortunately, we spoke about this. The person who put the PowerPoint together, she's an intern. I try to get her to guide everything together in the proper order. So we already went over that, so we can skip. So SSI, Supplemental Social Security Income. So our families that come in, we already know certain families who are a certain age won't be able to work full-time or they have certain medical or other disabilities where we're going to have to apply for SSI. SSI can take a while for them to get an approval, so, and it is a process because some of our families, they have some medical records from overseas, from where they're coming. Some don't have any medical records, so basically once they go to their first health screening appointment, that starts to build up their case for why they should receive SSI. So we're going to help guide our families through that process. And once a family is enrolled and is receiving benefits, they're going to receive this green card. So as you see, some of our families may have many different cards that they have to keep track of. And each card has a PIN number attached to it.
And again, sorry for not knowing all this, but
yeah.
SSI is the same as disability?
No.
No.
So this is SSI, and then there's SSDI. So the way I can simplify that, SSDI, Social Security, those are the individuals who paid into disability. So those are the individuals who actually paid.
SSDI is if you paid
yes,
into Social Security, and then you're on disability.
Yes.
This is like you get from the same bank of money, but you never pay.
It's
separate.
Yes, exactly, and it's not the same amount that a person who's been here and worked all their lives will receive. Majority of the time for an individual, the amount they receive a month is between $600 and $700. And most of the time, yes.
How often do they get rechecked to make sure that they still qualify?
I'm not sure how often they have to go to get rechecked. Before it was random, and then at one point it was like every 2 years or every 3 years, but I'm not sure at this current time what they have in place as guidelines. And we were told that it can take anywhere from 30 days up to 60 days, if not longer, to actually get a determination of whether or not the family is eligible.
I think it also depends on what the disability is.
Yes.
So certain things will check more often than others, if it's sort of like a permanently disabled.
The same, yes, exactly. And then some of the families, we don't wanna, even if a family member comes here and we know that they're disabled, say if they're in a wheelchair perhaps, we don't want to limit them and just place that label, because there's a lot of labels and we don't want to place that on them. Maybe they can work from home. Maybe they have computer skills. Maybe they can do something on the computer. Maybe they can sew and they can do it from home and then sell their items. Maybe they can cook and then sell it. So we're going to explore that with each member of the family and really talk to them. We have the employment specialist, really sit down, talk to them. We want to know what are their goals, what are their expectations coming here, what do they want to achieve. Some families may want to continue their education, go to school. Some may want to go to cooking school and stuff like that. There's a lot of families that we know are placed in low paying wage jobs, and we don't want them to feel like they have to work, for example, at a hotel as a maid because they don't speak good English. We want to give them all the opportunity, all the different benefits, and that's why we're going to really enforce English. It's very important, and we're going to do everything we can do to help the family learn English. So agency will provide employment referral and enrollment, so referrals to job trainings. We're going to help them find a job. We don't want it just a job. We want them to actually have a career, actually have a purpose, actually have a focus. Maybe they want to go on in the future. So this is it's ESOL classes now. It used to be ESL classes. So they're going to learn English, and on our timeline, you're going to see things on their calendar that says this in the morning they have, it's called cultural orientation, but the next day they have English classes or employment classes that they will attend. You have a question?
Are you using, or are any of us using the Mass Career and Development Center that's in the industrial park here?
I believe they're going to start in-house, and then after a certain point of time, there's an employment specialist at our agency, and then at a certain point of time, then they're going to be referred out to that agency, to the different agencies in the area.
Because the part of the contract is that Charities has to provide this and this and this and this. But
yes.
That's in the first month or the first 3 months.
Mm-hmm.
Then after that,
that's when we're going to, yes. If not before, and then we may have some individuals who come in here with a higher level of English, and they may can go to one of the other programs in the area right away to enroll.
Are the ESL classes that they're required to go to, are they required to go to certain specific ones for refugees, or just where are they going to ESL classes?
So they're going to go to our office in Northampton. So we're going to have an office, and they identify certain locations where they're going to have teaching the families. And then the first two families coming, there may be some difficulties because of the wheelchair and mobility issues. So we're actually going to go to the client's home. And we're not going to delay lessons. We're going to start right away.
I'm sorry, someone from Catholic Charities?
Yes.
Is that a CGSL?
Yes.
For a month?
No, well, to start with, yes.
And then hopefully continued education after that?
Yes.
Somewhere else?
Yes.
So we were told today at the co-leaders, the leaders meeting, that there's the whole list of people from the colleges and the universities
yes.
who have stepped up to volunteer to do classes or trained in ESOL instruction. And then after Catholic Charities responsibilities is over, then the Center for New Americans and the International Language Institute will step up.
Okay, we have to provide cultural orientation, so welcome to the United States. They will learn about the way and how things are done in the United States. unfortunately, that sounds terrible, but there are certain things that are frowned upon. So, yes. We don't mean to make it sound like that, but there are certain expectations. So there are certain boundary expectations. So there may be some family that are really touchy-feely and they wanna come and sit real nice and close to you and hug you and talk to you. And maybe there's some children who lack that boundary and will just go and sit on your lap and think nothing of it. So we had a conversation in our office today where we were talking about one of the families and I said, I thought this person only had one sister here in the United States, and another person, he is also a refugee, one of my coworkers, Joel. He said it to me, he said, if a person comes and live with you for 2 weeks or 3 months, that is your aunt, that is your sister, that is your brother. And for me, that's totally different. No, you're not my aunt, you're not my uncle. But for some of these children, that's what they know. They've been in certain relationships where multiple adults cared for them and that they looked up to different people. So their boundaries may be different than what our children. So our children knows, like, it's not okay to talk to strangers. It's not okay to go sit on a stranger's lap. There are certain things like hygiene. So, maybe everyone here is probably used to wearing some form of type of deodorant in some form or something, or some type of fragrance. Some of the refugees, they're not used to that. They don't have that. So they may not be aware of body odor and stuff like that. So our orientation talks about the different, basically, norms in America that we go by. So if they go to the store and they see toothpaste, this is what you use toothpaste for. This is what you use deodorant for. So in all the basics. And then we want in exchange, we want to learn what they know. We want to learn how things are done because they may have certain ways. They may make their own deodorant. So we may have to help them find the ingredients that they need. They may make their own clothing. Most of us probably go to the store and buy clothing. So they may only wear certain types of clothing. So this is, in this placement, so they have to receive a basic orientation within the first 30 days and then an extended cultural orientation throughout the 90 days. And the extended orientation will also include community orientation because we want them to get to know the community. That's where a lot of the circles of care members are gonna come in so that the family is comfortable with their surroundings. So we want them to know where the public services and facilities are in the Northampton area, personal and public safety. We want to introduce them to the local fire department. We want to introduce them to the local police department. We're going to introduce them to DCF so that way they know who and why this person is here.
Is DCF automatically going to get involved?
No. DCF, they offered to come in, and I'm not sure how much they're going to do, just to talk about certain things about, like, child abuse and stuff like that. So certain things that's legal versus illegal, and there's certain cultures, they do certain things. And we're asking you, if you see something that you think isn't normal, to please contact us right away and not contact DCF right away, because we really want to see if we can, maybe it's just cultural. So there was a community, they call it I'm not sure what it was, but they mentioned it was called coining, where they take the coin and, but it wasn't abuse. And there are certain things that are different.
Vietnamese,
thank you.
Yes. I have a question about that, which came up at our circle meeting, and I'm remembering that Keegan was gonna look into it, but
yes.
That there somebody was asking about mandatory reporting,
so,
and that as circle care leaders that we're mandatory reporters, and then, or that was the question, and there was...
So it all depends. So I'm not sure what the agreement, so someone's talked about the agreement that they had in place, talking about mandated reporters. Some of you may work in jobs where you are a mandated reporter. So even outside the agency, I am a mandated reporter. So if I see something, I'm supposed to report it.
But if we report to you, does that count? Or are we legally supposed to report to the police or to DCF?
I would have to look into that.
Okay.
But I think you're legally supposed to report to the police
or
DCF.
So that was the question, is like,
yes.
How to...
And I think they're going to work on that.
How to handle that when we're being asked, understandably, to not go directly to the police or DCF.
My thing is, if it's something blatant where if you see outright abuse, then my thing is if the child is in pain, needs emergency assistance. But if you see, there's different. Some parents believe in spanking, some parents don't. But if you see the parent go like a tap on the hand or something, we're asking you don't report that as to DCF as abuse. But if you see the parent is taking a belt buckle and hitting the child, then I believe that's something that is reportable. But we will also like you to report it to us so we're aware of it.
I mean, you could make a quick phone call to the case manager,
right,
and
ask,
say, what do I do?
What do I do? Yeah.
You know, the case manager is not going to blow you off.
No, exactly.
You know what I mean?
Right.
They're going to say, okay, we have to report this.
Exactly. Okay, any questions? I know it's a lot, and actually we'll go slower with the refugee families, we'll go over in more detail with the refugee families, we'll do it at their pace so that they can understand it.
And with a translator.
Yes, and with a translator, of course. we were thinking about translating the material, but we had a few refugees come forward, and they said they may not be able to read it, but if we have a translator, they can also translate it.
Yeah.
I'm going to do this family by family. Because the way I see it, we're not getting a massive amount of families in all at once. And I think, for me, I think individualized attention by the case manager is important. So wherever we can do is carve out time. If I can do it one-on-one with someone and then do it one-on-one with another family member, I will. So that way, when we get together as a group, maybe one understood it, but the other one didn't understand it, and then maybe they can talk together about what they did and didn't understand. Yes?
Can the circle leaders get a copy of this final presentation that they could share with their...
Sure. They didn't ask for it, but I can, yes. Sure. I can send a copy.
And just so people know, Ian from NCTV is filming hopefully all of the trainings. So and so people like who aren't at them can also access all of the information from the online site.
Yes.
My question was the same, but also like the timeline and the dates and the specific things that need to happen by certain time.
So we have a timeline in place.
Do we have a copy of that as the circle?
Yes.
The circles of care should have a copy of the timeline, but also what we're going to put in place is like a calendar, a monthly calendar of basically appointments, different orientations they have to do, different trainings, different classes they have to attend, so you know when the family is free. So if you're working that particular family, maybe you want to take them out on a Saturday and you see that they're free. So you'll be able to write in that you're going to take the family somewhere on that Saturday so that another member knows that that family is going to be gone that day. And we're going to post it up on their refrigerator or wherever they want it in their house so they can see it. And this way it'll give them a sense of knowing what's going to happen and when it's going to happen. Unfortunately, depending on the family arrival time, that's when the timeline starts. So for the first family, day one, depending on what time they arrive tomorrow, will be day one, and then the following day two will be day two. And then, so for the family that is arriving on Friday night, day one will be Friday, depending on which time, and then day two will either be Saturday or Sunday. So, and there's certain things that we have to do upon arrival. And then there's gonna be, over the weekend, since it's a holiday, the family will have some free time because our office is closed, but our case manager is still going to be in constant contact with the families, and if any question arises, and then we're also gonna have the circle of members, circles of care members there to assist the family with their needs. Yes? Yes, we are. They're gonna have cell phones. And then we're also, I'm also going to, through different translation apps that, so there's one that I've been testing that is really good and that has really good Arabic. And we're also going to share that one with everyone. So you can download the app and basically you speak into the app, you say something and then you hit play, it translates. And then you can hit the app again, they can say something. And I'm gonna look and see if that same app is on the client's phone, so that way you can go back and forth if needed. So if there's no one to translate, yes.
It was still in, today at our circle of the care leaders meeting, that the timeline we've had so far, it sort of had abbreviations of DTA and quick. And
yes.
Quick. And that's what we asked, like where are these meetings gonna be? And the same thing, just so people have a sense of if it's in Springfield, if it's in Holyoke.
And that's what the smaller calendar for each family will be. Because we have a family resettled in Northampton, their calendar is gonna look totally different from the family that's going to be resettled in Westfield. So we're going to, the family that's being resettled in Northampton, they're gonna have a calendar, and it's gonna have the name, the time, and the dates, and we're gonna share that with the circles of care.
So, I hate to harp on these things, but, you know, the caring health center is going to do those first few visits.
Yes.
Then if you have a diabetic or someone with hypertension or someone with a significant medical problem, you know, it could take 2.5 months to get into an office.
Well,
so that's my question to you.
So we have, I'm not sure the exact name, but I believe it's like a medical working group here within an basically, they identify base state here, and they're prepared, and they are ready.
No, so I'm asking whether base state on King Street is ready to take an adult or a kid, you know, within a week or two of their arrival if they have a medical problem that needs to be dealt with. That's my question.
It's my understanding that, yes, they are.
Yeah. Okay. No, I understand that they do, but that's not.
Garrison is sort of the point person in the social services group that I'm in.
Okay, I just want to make sure that they're going to get what they need.
Yes, no one's going to fall through the cracks. They're going to get what they need. Even if they don't have health insurance, they're still going to get the proper medical care needed. Yes.
With the family that's arriving in Northampton, I'm just thinking about the ages of the sons. One at 20 would still qualify as under 22 for certain services, but the 26-year-old, will he have to apply as an adult and then she'll be head of household? And
so the way it works is, even though we lump them together as one case,
yeah.
But the 20-year-old and the mother is one case, and then that separate person is another separate case. So for our purposes, we lumped them together because they are family and we know they're going to want to live together. But for benefits purposes, they will all be separate. He will be separate, yes.
And when the younger one turns 22, that will happen as well. Is that the age?
No, I don't think so. I think the younger one, the reason why, I'm not sure why they put his case, but usually we saw an 18-year-old had their own case before. But with this case, I'm not sure. The 20-year-old may be the primary caretaker of the mother, so that's why they put that person.
My teenager can stay on my health insurance until 22, so yes. Maybe something
it's
like that.
26.
It's 26.
26.
Yeah.
But they would. So depending on what they want to do, right now we're assuming they're gonna wanna all live together because they live in close quarters right now. We've been told by other individuals that these families don't wanna be separated, even if they have to live in one bedroom together.
Where are they from?
They're from, this family is from, originally from Iraq, I believe.
Kurdish.
Yes, and they're in, is this the family that's in Turkey, perhaps? Coming from Turkey. They're coming from, I believe this family's coming from Turkey.
And that's to Northampton or Westfield?
That's Northampton.
Okay. And the Westfield family is also gonna be with one of our circles?
No.
Okay.
Because basically they have their own community in Westfield and they're gonna have their own like little mini circle with their family.
Okay.
But if we need assistance and if we see them, we don't want, if we see the family isn't assistant, like everyone has good intentions. So there may be a time where we have to call upon the circles of care to see who can help assist with the family if their actual immediate family doesn't help.
So are they considered one of the 10 families
that have to care for? No, so there's a total of 6. These are 6 of the 51.
People, 6 of 51.
Yes.
3 and 3.
3 and 3.
Okay.
They are part of, yes.
Are you the case manager for all the Northampton refugee families coming in?
So, I'm not the exact actual case manager, but I'm going to oversee everything. So, majority of everything will go through me, and I will have to say on certain things. I will coordinate with the actual case manager and give them guidance on what they need to do and how it should be done and if something is wrong. So that's why all the leaders will go through me and then I will speak to the actual case managers. In some instances, you may have the actual case manager's cell phone. I know that they were getting cell phones, so and the client will have their actual case manager information. But all the members will have my cell phone information to call me. So all the questions will go through me.
And are all the case managers through Catholic Charities?
Yes, they are. Okay. All our case managers are through Catholic Charities.
So there's several. It's not, I know Joelle is not the only.
So there's Joelle, and then we have another case manager called Father Bill.
And they're going to be managing all 51 cases?
Yes.
Okay.
I know that this was fast and everything.
Oh, that was great. Thank you so much.
Thank you.